We're rolling. Do you know what that means when I say we're rolling?
I'm not talking. I'm going to keep my fucking mouth shut.
I told you to keep your mouth shut. Let me do all the talking and get us all in trouble. You know that. What?
I've done it before. That's what I do. I get people in trouble by talking.
Daniel Lappin has been on our show before. It's been a while, though. He is a comedy writer and actor. He is the writer and creator of Israel's longest-running sitcom, Life Isn't Everything. I think it ran for 9 seasons in Israel. He's also created Split, that ran last season on Reshet, Israel's Channel 2. Please welcome back to our show, Israeli comedy writer and actor, Daniel Lappin. Hello, Daniel.
Yeah, hi. Everything is right, but I am not an actor. You just added something to my resume, and I'm happy to have it, but if we're going to go with fact, no, I'm not. I've acted in my show, but just for the hell of it.
Okay, and where in Israel are you joining us?
Well, Israel is very small.
All right, can I just give me an answer.
I'll shut up.
I got questions I want to ask. Where in Israel?
What is it going to say to you? It's Hakadinki. It means nothing. It's a town called Herzliya. Now say it. Have you ever heard of it? Have you ever been there? It's just outside of Tel Aviv. It's a suburb of Tel Aviv. Herzliya. You got the name? Be happy.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. It's going to be tough the whole way, you know?
All right. I want to talk to you about Secretary of State Kerry, the settlements in the West Bank.
Oh, my favorite subjects. Yes. I love to talk about these things.
And you were on the show about 2 years ago when Israel was going up against Hamas and Gaza, and you're very critical of Netanyahu. You would be, I would say, associated with the Labor Party.
No. The Labor Party? The Labor Party is not a left-wing party. It's not nothing. I don't know what it is anymore. It used to be a very right-wing party. That's the party that initiated and executed basically the Six-Day War.
Who was Shimon Peres?
He was Labor. He then left Labor. But he was, first of all, Peres, a great man. He's the man.
God, can I just do the intro without you? I'm trying to get to a point.
You can't ask a question, not accept an answer. I'll give you the short answer. Shimon Peres was a man, okay? I'll give you the answer.
Thank you. Okay.
You're welcome.
And he was beloved in America among American Jews.
In Israel, too. He was a great guy.
He was a great man. You know, I want to talk to you about the situation in Israel vis-a-vis the Palestinians. I want to inform my listeners. One of the things that I'm discovering is people have opinions in America based on opinions, not facts. So what I'd like to do with you is have you vent for a minute. Let it all out. Let me hear your anger and rage about what's going on in Israel. Then I want you to inform my listeners. Fair enough?
Okay. No. First of all, if you want me to vent and rage and let it all out, I need a week at least just to start. That's one thing. Second of all, I don't know if I am Mr. Fact or anything. I'm not. I'm just the guy with an opinion. That's about it.
Well, unfortunately, in America, we have to turn to comedians and comedy writers to inform because we don't have journalists on radio or television. We have opinions. So give me your opinion. Give me your opinion about Secretary of State Kerry's speech and what you think of Benjamin Netanyahu, the longest-serving or self-serving prime minister in Israel's history.
He's done more years than my sitcom. but he's less funny, I think. Kerry's speech, in my opinion, was a pro-Israel speech. Just a minute. I hope I'm not getting shot now. What did Kerry say? Kerry said that Israel has to choose. Is it going to be a democratic state?
What is the state? Are you clicking your nails? What is that clicking sound? Are you doing?
I told you, it's my heart. It's my heart. No, I'm doing my nails. Yeah, I always wait for a Skype conversation from New York to Israel to do my nails. It's a thing I have. Am I clicking now?
That's the NSA. Or Shin Bet.
Yeah, or, you know, just it's Carrie applauding quietly. I don't know.
Okay.
Do you am I clicking now?
With me, you're clicking. Okay.
Am I still? Oh, actually, okay.
We're doing well.
No, seriously, you're going to edit all this shit out. But
no, I'm not. Clicking? No, I'm not going to edit.
Oh, this is real live to tape. Okay. I thought that the speech was great. I don't know, great. I thought it was in place. Israel is getting a blank check from the states all the time, and it's time to put a stop to this. It's like if you see somebody running around with a gun and you're going to support him, you're going to keep him with the gun? No, you're going to take the gun away from him. Putting a stop to the insane settlements and the settling, this obsessive fanatic settling that this right-wing government is pushing forward is the right thing to do.
Do you like Benjamin Netanyahu? He's the prime minister. He is part of the Likud coalition?
No, Likud is the main party that forms the coalition. He's the party. He's the head of the Likud party, and the Likud party formed a coalition with.
That's basically what I said, but you still felt the need to correct me.
No, you said it totally wrong. I just had to correct you.
What did I say? I said he was.
You said the Likud coalition. You said it right. Okay, you win.
He's the prime minister, so he had to form a coalition in the Knesset.
Yeah, it's a different political system, which is not great. Better than yours, because you have, let me think, the stupidest political system in the world. But it's not a great one here either. It's got its problems. I guess all political systems have a problem. Not like yours. Yours is really like the to win an election but lose it. That's unique for America.
Israel's won a couple of wars and lost land. So don't.
Yeah, I'm not. I'm not. I'm trying to, you know, be represent.
All right. I want to inform.
I did not vote for Netanyahu.
Who'd you vote for?
I voted for a party called Meretz, which is you can call it left wing. It's a sane party. Sanity means that you cannot continue settling. You cannot control. Wait, hold on. You cannot control. I just got a message from you. You cannot control millions of Palestinians in land where they are a clear majority.
Okay.
You cannot occupy territories and claim to be and not give them any rights.
You're going to have to let me control this conversation. Okay.
Yeah, you wanted to talk about you're a controlling guy. I see why things went the way they did with you. Go on.
What, you're talking about my marriage?
Definitely. That's one of the topics we have to talk about, is it not?
Well, I was hoping to talk about the situation in Israel and why my ex-wife is very similar to the Palestinians, but that's neither. Are you still married?
First of all, the conflict that in the Middle East resembles, I guess, a lot of what you've been going through. Wait, are you divorced?
Pretty much.
Really? And are you happy?
Okay, so
I'm married. Yeah, I have two little kids.
Oh, you remarried?
You met me, I was remarried. And my ex-wife and my wife are friends. We have dinners together, and it's all one big happy family.
Okay. So you voted for what was the name of the political party you voted for?
Meretz. Meretz is a sane party. They're considered left.
You said sane, S-A-N-E.
Yeah, it's a sane party. It's a party that looks for some kind of sanity. They're very honest party.
Is that what do they call themselves? Is that what?
No. I'm saying that it is a sane party. I do not understand the Labor Party, which for some reason you call a left-wing party. The head of the Labor Party. Wait, I'm ranting.
Go ahead.
You want to control it. Go on.
Okay. And when you vote for Meretz, you're voting for the parliamentarian who is standing in your district?
No, we don't have districts. It doesn't work like that.
They're at large?
You cast a vote and they just count all of the votes that went in for Meretz. And if they pass a certain threshold, then they have three members of Knesset. That's it. There's no district. It doesn't work like that here.
And who do you complain when the trains aren't running? Who do you complain to? Do you have a
My wife, the no, you. It's pretty easy to get to a member of Knesset of the party you vote. Even I had a problem, and some guy from the Likud solved it for me. Of course, it was easier for me because I work with, you know, friends in the press and stuff like that. But they're accessible. You can get to members of parliament. It's a small country, so you're not talking about hundreds of millions of people. So if you make an effort, you're going to get to a member of Knesset. And a lot of these people are effective, even if they're in the wrong party. They will. You can work with these guys, even if they have, you know, their approach to the Palestinian problem is or the Palestinian the conflict is something that I could never subscribe to. Still, you can talk to a lot of these people, and they can be helpful.
Let's go over the history. Tell us, explain to us what's going on.
Come on, the history. You gotta be more specific.
What are the settlements? When I ask Americans about the settlements, they have no idea what it means. So what are the settlements?
First of all, do you want to go back to 1948, the first partition plan? Let's go to 1967. 1967, there was the Six-Day War. I can't believe I'm giving a history lesson here. So, there was the Six-Day War, June 1967, where Israel captured the Sinai Desert and the West Bank, which is mainly comprised of Palestinians who were citizens of Jordan. We captured it in a war against Jordan. The Sinai was returned to Egypt for a peace agreement, which is considered the cold peace, but it works. We haven't had any bloodshed with Egypt since 1981 when the agreement was signed. But the conflict with the Palestinians, and we captured the Golan Heights from Syria in 1967. I was barely alive then. The settlements are...
So there are two pieces of property, and I cover this in the next segment of our show, but just it's hard to keep track of for my listeners, so I want to go over this. There's the Gaza Strip, which the Israelis got from the Egyptians. It's in the Sinai Desert.
We didn't get it. We captured it. It's not in the Sinai Desert. It's bordering on the Sinai Desert.
And when was that taken from the Egyptians?
1967. In the 1967 war, Israel captured the West Bank, all of Sinai, including the Gaza Strip, and the Golan Heights from Syria.
Okay, and so they returned. So when did they return the Sinai but keep the Gaza Strip?
1981. Well, it was in stages, but basically 1981, the peace accord was signed with Egypt. Anwar Sadat came to Israel. Let's break the stalemate. And Sinai was returned to Egypt, and Gaza stayed with Israel.
Why did Israel want the Gaza Strip? Two questions. Why did Israel want to keep the Gaza Strip? Were there a lot of Palestinians at that time living in the Gaza Strip? And
yes.
Were there a lot of Palestinians living in the Sinai Desert, or was it just an empty plot of land?
Empty plot of land. There were Bedouin tribes living there, and Gaza was overpopulated, and is even more so now.
And yes. Why did Israel want the Gaza Strip?
I don't know. I think that Egypt did not want it back. I have no answer for that. I'm not sure.
Is it because that is where a preponderance of Palestinians were living, and they wanted to
watch. Why would Israel?
I'm saying, is that why Egypt was willing to give it up?
Oh, yeah, I think so. But you know what? I'm sure that any history teacher, this is a question that, why did Israel actually keep the Gaza Strip? I don't know. That was a dumb thing to do. But in 2000, like 10 years ago, I think it was, Israel vacated the Gaza Strip.
Under Ariel Sharon. Yeah, but here's my question. Are there Palestinians living in Egypt? In other words, did the Palestinians just all kind of congregate in the Gaza Strip? Were they kind of forced into the Gaza Strip by the Egyptians?
During the 48 war, the War of Independence, a lot of Palestinians were displaced from where they were living. People that were living in what is now Central Israel, people living in all over the country, they were displaced and they were put into refugee camps. They weren't. Yeah, I know what you're leaning to.
I'm not leaning to anything. You know what? I don't have an opinion. This is the other thing. I'm not arguing. I'm trying to inform my listeners because I am amazed at people, really smart people who have opinions about Israel who don't know this stuff, but they have opinions. So I'm just asking you, Gaza was...
I have endless opinions about stuff. My best opinions are about things I don't know.
Okay, so Gaza, which is kind of like on the southern border of Israel and Egypt, is where Palestinians who were under Egyptian rule, that's where they gathered. The Palestinians after 48, after the War of Independence, or the catastrophe, as the Palestinians call it.
The Nakba, they call it the Nakba, yeah.
They were not absorbed into Egypt and made citizens. They were kind of put in Gaza by the Egyptians, right?
Right, yeah.
Is that correct?
I don't know. Were they there before? I'd have to check that. You know what? You have me again.
Okay.
I don't know if they were the result of refugees that were escaping, or how much of it was. I think that Gaza was a big city before that already. I don't know. I think that it was meant to be part of the Palestinian state in any case. But you know what?
I'm not sure. Is it a coastal?
Yeah, sure. They have a city. They have a, yeah, of course.
So that's one of the reasons Israel would have wanted it, right?
No, I don't think so. It's not clear to me. I think that in 1971, Golda Meir, he offered, Sadat offered, this is how beautiful the Labor Party is.
Sadat was the leader of Egypt.
He was the leader of Egypt after Nasser, who was the nationalist, the great Arab nationalist. Sadat became the leader, and he broke the stalemate by coming to the Knesset in 1977. Knesset is Israel's parliament, and saying, let's talk peace. This was in 1977. This was after the 1973 war, very hard war. In 1971, Sadat sent an offer for peace to Golda Meir, who was then the prime minister, and said, let's make peace. You will be able to keep the areas of settlements in the Sinai. Let's just make peace. But give me back the rest of the Sinai. In Israel, in the Sinai, there was a settlement area, an area called Yamit. Yamit was a city that Israel built, also a settlement in Sinai. Israel dismantled the settlement and gave it back to the Egyptians. According to the peace agreement that Sadat offered in 1971, we could have kept it. But Golda Meir said, we don't make peace. We're not giving anything back. We want it in war. And I'm for peace, I'm willing to give peace. Then the 1973 war broke out, and we had a peace agreement with less advantageous conditions. This is the Labor Party, by the way.
Okay, again...
By the way, then farther right, I'd say, than the Likud now. They've changed.
Okay, so that's the Gaza Strip. And how many people live in the Gaza Strip right now?
You know what? I don't know. Probably around two, I don't know. You want me to check it out as we're talking?
No, that's all right.
Millions. I don't know, maybe close to 2 million, I think, but I don't have the number.
And is it still a
source? You're talking like I'm an authority. I'm a writer. I write comedy. Yeah, go on.
Is it still a source of cheap labor? Or is anybody from Gaza allowed into Israel?
They trickle in. It's not a source of cheap labor. It's highly monitored. People that come in, it's very monitored because there's a lot of violence coming in from Gaza.
Okay. And Gaza has been pretty much turned into a cesspool? It's kind of like a walled in. Is it fair to call it a walled in ghetto where there are no real jobs and it's a Hobbesian nightmare?
Apparently unemployment is very high. But you know, look at some pictures of Gaza on the internet. You can find places that look horrible, like 12th world, and you'll also find areas that are okay, that are not as that look more modern. But essentially what happened was Israel...
Now, answer my questions.
I don't know. You're asking, again... It's bordered from the Egyptian side. It's walled off from the Egyptians. It's walled off from Israel. They're allowed to come into Israel to work, but in very small numbers. It's not a source of cheap labor the way it used to be, like around 20 years ago.
Okay.
It is walled off, and they're not allowed to have. They don't have an airport. You can understand for security reasons why a country would be kind of worried about giving the Hamas an airport, but they basically it's humanitarian stuff that gets in there.
Okay. Now, there's the Gaza Strip, and it's pretty much run by Hamas, which is different from the Palestinian Authority.
Yeah, this is what we might call the three-state solution. Because, you know.
Okay, and then there's the West Bank, right, which is run by the Palestinian Authority, which is kind of like a colonial government set up by America, the Arab League, and the United States through a series of treaties. Right?
No, I don't think it's like that. They have a president.
They have Mohammed Abbas, who's the president of the Palestinian Authority, right?
Right, yeah.
And he represents the Fatah party, which is Yasser Arafat's political party from the PLO, correct?
You're doing great, yeah.
And Hamas is a terrorist organization / political party.
Religious, by the way. Very religious.
And they are challenging and have been challenged.
They're recognized as a terrorist organization, by the way.
They're recognized as a terrorist organization and a political party within the Palestinian Authority that goes up against Fatah.
So it's not within the Palestinian Authority. They're not part of the Palestinian Authority. It's like a party within a Palestinian party. It is
a terrorist organization that is also a political party within the Palestinian Authority. Right?
Okay.
The same way.
I don't know how much representatives, how many representatives they have in the Palestinian parliament.
The same way Fatah would be the political party of the PLO, which is a terrorist organization.
Fatah forms the government.
Well, that's because Fatah. Give me that bullshit. Yeah.
Sorry that there are other languages other than English in the world. Why are Americans so... I don't want to say it.
Go ahead, say it. Do you know what it's like to be both a self-hating Jew and a self-hating American?
Why do the Americans believe that the sun shines directly from every American's asshole? It's not true. There's a whole world out there. There's many, many, many people that speak different languages and have different cultures. It's not all Americans as you were going to discover very soon, by the way.
Well, let me tell you something, partner. If it weren't for America, the people in Israel would be speaking German right now. And not too loudly. And don't you forget
Why would we be speaking German?
Because what are you clicking there? I know you're surfing the web. And knock it off.
I'm not.
You're multitasking here, and I'm trying to educate my listeners.
Yeah. Okay. Here's just one thought for you. Israel. It's true, by the way. Israel's greatest ally, but I have very serious reservations about the government here. The Israeli government. Don't look at me and say, "Wow, I'm proud of all that stuff." Second thing is, if America had not gone to the First World War,
Going
back to the First World, Second World War. I'll go back to the First World War.
Go ahead.
Go on. No, go ahead.
Say what you want to say. America did
the right thing. But if America, it was totally the right thing. In hindsight, if America had not gone on into the First World War, there'd never been a Holocaust because Germany would have not lost the war. And
okay.
Of course, most of Europe would be speaking German, but the Nazi Party would have never been formed. Anyway, that's just all speculation. What would have happened in the butterfly effect?
Yes. Okay.
I can imagine some historian is now ripping his hair out, saying, "What crap?"
Okay. Let's get back so my listeners can understand what's going on in Israel, so they have a reason to hate the Jews. my goal here is not to hate Jews just because you have a gut. You're trusting your gut.
Hate Jews for the right reason.
I want you to hate the Jews trusting your brain. So the situation with the Palestinians and the settlements, I just want to paint this picture so the audience understands. You have Gaza, and you have the West Bank. Those are two non-contiguous pieces of land that belong to the Palestinians, sort of.
Yes.
And they are ruled by the what is called the Palestinian Authority, which is kind of like a parliament for the Palestinians. And the president of the Palestinian Authority is Mohammed Abbas, or Abu Mazen. He has two names. And he is a disciple of Yasser Arafat, which means he's a member of the Fatah Party, which is the political arm of the PLO, which was a terrorist organization. There was an election held in Gaza, about 10 years ago, and Hamas won. Correct?
In Gaza, yeah.
They won in Gaza, and the United States refused to accept that, and the Palestinian Authority, which is pretty much headquartered, I believe, in Ramallah in the West Bank, refused to accept Hamas into their parliament.
A civil war. And so it is, and Israel refused.
And Israel refused to. They kind of supervise the Palestinian parliament, correct?
Israel?
Well, Israel refused to recognize Hamas.
Yeah, I don't know what that means, supervise the Palestinian parliament. I have no idea what that means. But yeah, the Israel did not recognize the Hamas victory.
Right.
So and, I'll say like you, like Hamas victory.
And so what we now have in Israel and or Palestine Israel. In Palestine.
I gotta correct a few things. In 10 years ago, Israel withdrew from.
Hang on. Nobody understands what's going on.
You're painting a picture that is not right.
All right. Let me wrap it up.
There's some kind of correlation.
Let me just wrap this up so my audience understands. So what you have,
wrongly though, and then I will correct you.
Then correct me. So what you have is you have Fatah and the Palestinian Authority controlling the West Bank, and you have Hamas in Gaza controlling Gaza with pretty much no consultation from the Palestinian Authority and Mohammed Abbas. It's two separate Palestinian states. Is that a fair assessment?
No, it's not.
Okay.
Just hold on. It's my writing part. Okay. The Palestinian Authority, the West Bank, there is divided into certain areas, C, A, B, and C. All these territories are subject to Israeli military control. Israel can go into Ramallah at any time. There is a Palestinian security force, police force, that does a pretty good job. But Israel can go in whenever they want. They also settle there. They build settlements.
We're talking about the West Bank.
In the West Bank. Israel did not withdraw from the West Bank. Israel does not go in, does not have an army base in Ramallah, but they have army bases in the West Bank, and they can go into Ramallah. They will go into Ramallah if there's need. And it's not a war because we never left the West Bank. Israel never left the West Bank. We left certain areas in the West Bank, we didn't proclaim a border there. It says, okay, we're not going to go into Ramallah. That's the easiest way to describe it. Israel did leave Gaza. Israel withdrew, built a wall, and we cannot settle. Israel cannot build a settlement in Gaza. Nobody in his right mind would do that. We are not part of Gaza anymore. It's a separate entity. It's not under military rule. All of the West Bank is under military rule, under military Israeli rule. The Israeli army sits on the Jordan River, basically encircling all of the West Bank. That's why Israel is building settlements there. The settlements that were built in Gaza were dismantled. Gaza is a different story than the West Bank. It's not as if they're equal. Okay, that should be clear. And we should also say that after Israel left Gaza, Israel was bombarded with missiles from Gaza. So if you're going to be on the right, a right winger, then you can say, here's what happens when we give back land. not only do we give back the land, but we're also getting missiles. So here's proof. Do not give back land because you're going to be bombarded with missiles.
So Gaza is more of a problem than the West Bank.
No, both of them are terrible problems.
Okay, and who and is it fair to say that there are two separate Palestinian people or Palestinian states? Gaza and the West Bank are two separate nations.
Yeah, well, they're not nations. I mean,
but potentially two separate nations.
The problem, what I was trying to say was, when you get missiles thrown, Israel left Gaza without an agreement. They walked out of there and they left a total mess. If they had possibly reached an agreement, left with some kind of agreement, maybe it would be. It would
this was like a, this was like 11 years ago when Ariel Sharon was prime minister.
Yeah. Exactly, but Gaza supposedly is closer to being an independent entity. I don't know if it's a state. They can't do much there because they're encircled by Egypt and Israel on all sides, and they can't really develop much. But you could think that if they had any, you know, if they were peace-loving, then they could have taken all the money they built on missiles and built hospitals.
So they are more self-governing than the West Bank.
Yes.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No. Ask the question. I have nothing of importance to say.
There was a time before Israel pulled out of the West Bank. Pulled out of Gaza. Before Sharon pulled out of Gaza, I think it was like 11 years ago, there was an operation in the West Bank under Sharon about 12 years ago. I don't have the chronology in front of me. They cleaned out the West Bank. They found all the nasty terrorists, and they put them in Gaza, didn't they?
No, not aware of that. There were always operations in Gaza when Israel had settlements there. I don't any major cleansing.
But there was a period about 12 years ago where
people were banned from the West Bank and they were put in Gaza. Yeah, it wasn't some kind of overall thing. There were several people that were some were banned into Lebanon, by the way.
So there was a period where under Sharon, the Israeli army was going door to door in the West Bank looking for terrorists and not, you know, sometimes killing them, but mostly kicking them out.
Yeah. You got to understand, there were periods where there were buses blowing up in the middle of Tel Aviv and 30, 40 people were being killed.
Yeah.
I'm not mitigating the suffering of the other side. I'm not making it look as if it was some kind of walk in the park. But people were... They didn't go from door to door every, you know, like it wasn't overall scanning all of the population of Gaza, but they...
The West Bank. They went door to door.
I meant to say the West Bank. Yeah, they were not going door to door. I mean, when you had a terrorist attack or a scare or the Secret Service was onto something, then they would go door to door to
pick up people. They were going door to door.
Whoever told you they were going door to door... Boy, you're making me right wing. When I hear this kind of stuff, you're turning me into a right wing, and that's pretty hard to do. Okay, this did not happen. Israel has in control with a very iron fist, but they were not going to every single door. You want to know what an iron fist is? It's on Purim, which is an Israeli holiday in around March, when the kids in Hebron, which is an Arab city, wanted to go to walk out in their in dressing up, because Purim is like Halloween. You dress up, but there's no trick or treat, so you dress up for nothing. But then they would put under a curfew, I don't know, 400,000 Arabs in Hebron now, or I don't know how many are there, several hundred thousand. That is an iron fist. You're dealing with stuff that is not actual. It's going from door to door. You're training. It's like last time you told me when we spoke that Israel has a drone hovering outside of each out of the hospital in Gaza, and each birth is recorded. That's bullshit. It doesn't exist. Israel would not spend money on that. No government would authorize a thing like that just for the expenditure. So you have enough trouble without the inventions of going to every single door. Yeah, a lot of terrorists were ousted.
I didn't mean like every single door.
No, but it sounds like there was some kind of overall operation where thousands of people were ousted. No, it did not happen. several, tens of people, maybe hundreds were ousted. I don't even think, though. There was one thing, I think it was under Rabin, where, 180 were ousted to Lebanon. This is what you're dealing with. It's always a conflict that is touch and go. There's never any overall thing where the...
Right. Now, Rabin was the prime minister of Israel, and he was assassinated in 96.
No, 95.
He was assassinated in 95. Why don't we... 95 and a half. Is that good enough?
It was... No, it was 95. There's no 95. It was in November 95.
We'll say... Why don't we say February of 96?
No, it was towards the end of 1995. That
why
was
don't we say towards the beginning of 96?
Because it was the end. No, it was, by the way, that was the saddest thing that happened that I can remember in my adult life in a public level where that was the death of hope. And there was a little bit of hope after Barack won and then proved to be totally incompetent.
You're talking about Ehud Barak.
Yeah, totally.
Not Barack Obama.
Not Barack Obama. Yeah, that's also...
Do you know that if Ehud Barak married Barack...
Yes, I have. Barack.
Let me do my joke. If Ehud Barak married Barack Obama, he'd be Ehud Obama.
Okay, yeah. Good joke, by the way.
Thank you. Thank you. Ehud
good
Barak.
Use of our time.
Oh, so Ehud Barak... What? Say, go ahead.
I don't know. I said good use of time, good use of humor. Everything is there.
Okay, so Rabin wanted, he was strong-armed by Bill Clinton, and he and Yasser Arafat, what, in 93, 94, is that where the Oslo Accord started?
Yep.
And they got the Nobel Peace Prize?
Yep.
And from the Oslo Accord, you have the Palestinian Authority, which is set up, where Yasser Arafat could go from being a terrorist to becoming the father of a nation, correct?
It's a bit of a stretch, but yeah, okay, that was the idea, yeah.
And then Rabin, who was labor?
Yep.
Liberal?
Labor.
Yeah, kind of liberal. There was a parliamentary election, and Netanyahu pretty much incited the mob to assassinate him.
No, that's a real stretch.
Leah Rabin, the wife of Yitzhak Rabin, Leah Rabin said to Netanyahu when he came to her husband's funeral, "You killed him, you son of a bitch."
Yeah, okay. Listen, I don't remember her saying that to him.
I added, you son of a bitch, but she said at the funeral, you killed him.
All she said was, "You son of a bitch," that's all. And he said, "Yeah, you know my mother." So, it was all okay. No, there were several... It was an insane time where the country was totally split. And Rabin was being attacked by the right wing, called a traitor. And there was a parade. And the heads of the Likud were standing on some balcony. And they were there. The parade, the right wing demonstrators were walking by with pictures of Rabin in a Nazi suit, wearing a keffiyeh. And this is what he did not incite. He did not, Netanyahu did not say, go kill Rabin. He did not do anything to stop it. But I truly doubt that he believed that that was what was going to happen.
But Netanyahu was head of Likud, right wing, attacking Rabin for dealing with Arafat, and was pretty incendiary and revved up the Orthodox Jews, one of whom took it very seriously, and shot Rabin.
Listen, however you look at it, there's no way that you can pin this solely on Netanyahu. There was a whole group of Likud leaders that were on that balcony, including Sharon, by the way, including Sharon, who later changed his approach. But it's not, you make it sound like Netanyahu killed Rabin or said, "Hey guys, take a gun." No, it did not happen. That's not what happened.
Sharon, who was head of the Likud, became prime minister. Then did he form Kadima? He formed his own party after that, right?
Yeah. Yep.
Was it Kadima?
Yep.
Is it fair to say he became the prime minister? He was Likud, a war hero. he was as tough as they come. He was probably the most despised Israeli for American Jewry. They were embarrassed of Ariel Sharon. And yet, when he became prime minister, Yasser Arafat and he went eyeball to eyeball, and he was tough, but he pulled out. He was the one who pulled out of Gaza, who said the settlements have to go. And it was that Nixon goes to China moment where only Ariel Sharon from the Likud, a general who during the Lebanon War in 82, many say committed war crimes by allowing, I believe, the Christian militia to go into a refugee camp and kill Palestinians.
900, Sabran Shatila.
Yeah. Pretty much despised by American Jewry, you know, a tough general. He was going to create a Palestinian state for Yasser Arafat, and then he had a massive stroke.
I don't know how far he was going to go with that. We'll never know. He was considered a very far right-wing, tough, strong man, as you said. But his roots were in the Labor Party. He was a man of labor all his years in his youth. And
he approve of Netanyahu right now?
I doubt it. I strongly doubt it.
That's why he formed Kadima. He didn't like what Netanyahu...
He said, now from here, in this role of prime minister, I see things I didn't see. And we have to reach an agreement. Listen, David, something has to be very clear. Now, let's get back to the present now, okay? Let's leave the history system lesson because it's going to be endless. Let's talk about the present for a second. It's not as if Israel has who to talk to. Olmert, who was a prime minister before Netanyahu, and Barak before that, they both offered the Palestinians dream deals. There's things they'll never get. And they said no. This is fact. Clinton said it happened in Camp David with Barak. It happened later on with – they were offered everything they basically wanted, but they wanted a little more. They didn't – not everything, but in a negotiation, you'll get everything. That's one thing that should be stated clearly. That's one side of the story. The other side, now you say, if I say that, why would I be in support of what Kerry said or in support of the UN resolution, which I think is a pro-Israel resolution? Because the settlements, first of all, are draining Israel financially. And also, it costs a lot of money to build those settlements. Speculation or I don't know, the statistics are that the government spends on a settler five times more than on a regular citizen, because each citizen costs money, except for you, by the way, David. They told me that you don't cost any money to the states. Hmm. Are you there?
Yeah, I'm listening. I'm fascinated.
Okay. Regardless of the fact that there's nobody to talk to and nobody to do a deal with, or there wasn't then, I don't know about now, you cannot build these settlements because that ensures that there will never be anybody to talk to, because if you're going to have... Now there's over 500,000 Israelis living in the occupied territories. How are you going to get them out of there? How are you ever going to get them out of there? The more you have in there, the less chance you're ever going to have getting them out of there. Like they were removed from Gaza. There were settlements. There were several thousand in Gaza. And that was a traumatic thing for the country. So basically, the more you settle, the more chances you have of creating one state that is – has Arabs and Jews. And as Kerry said, you have to decide, are you a Jewish state? If you're a Jewish state, then you cannot occupy, you cannot continue settling because you're taking over lands with hundreds of millions of Arabs. So if you want to be democratic, you have to give them the right to vote. They'll vote in an Arab prime minister. So what do you want to do with the country? But there's no decision. I'll tell you something else. The occupied territories, except for the Jerusalem area, have never been annexed. Do you understand what I'm saying?
They were never brought into the Israel proper.
Yeah. The Arabs in East Jerusalem are considered Israeli citizens. They can get benefits from the Israeli Social Security, which is okay, and Israeli health medicine, which is only around a million times better than the crap you have in the States. Some of them choose not to do it for specific reasons, whatever. But aside from that, the Jerusalem area, which is a huge area, they keep on making Jerusalem bigger because they want to annex more, but most of the land has not been annexed. You have to ask yourself, why? We've had right-wing governments for the past 10 years, Netanyahu, why haven't they annexed it? They have not annexed it. So then you say, so if they haven't annexed it, then it's not really part of Israel. It's a different kind of land. So it's a whole mess. A country has borders.
Okay, Israel's so are you saying they haven't annexed East Jerusalem?
No, East Jerusalem has been annexed.
Where? But they're putting settlements where? In Jerusalem, right?
Well, the Jerusalem area. No, they're putting settlements in the middle of beside Hebron, not in the Jerusalem area, not in the, what is considered the municipal area of Greater Jerusalem. All over the West Bank, all over areas that are far from Jerusalem, that are isolated, that even in any, even if there was a land swap, you would never swap those pieces of land. It's, you know, just it's doing it as a kind of thorn in the face of the world and the Palestinians, putting settlements in far out areas in the middle of Palestinian populations. And then, of course, the army has to guard those. There's also another thing that settlements will be put up that are illegal. And the Supreme Court of Israel will say this is illegal. You can't have a settlement there. You know, they will rule that you have to dismantle it. The government then will then argue that. I mean, the government is basically doing illegal stuff against, like, as if it hates itself. It hates the country. Because, I mean, I guess abiding by the rules of the Supreme Court is something that is mandatory to keep a normal state running.
The nation of Israel is being changed by Netanyahu. There was a time when there was a vocal opposition. He has kind of, aren't people kind of shutting up about him now? And isn't a new, I think I read a Pew poll that said more and more Israelis are throwing up their hands and saying, you know what? I don't think a two-state solution is possible anymore.
He is not putting people in jail. We're not talking about.
But are more and more Israelis becoming right-wing when it comes to the Palestinian question?
Yes, totally. Like in the world, by the way, what's happening in the world? There's some kind of insanity that's going on in the world. I don't know. It might be a result of, I can only speculate. You know, you'd see Brexit, you see the Trump victory. Well, that was actually a Russian victory. But you see this insanity that's overtaken the once sane countries of the world. You say, okay, we have it too. I don't know how sane Israel was, but it was saner. Maybe it's some kind of response to ISIS, to the insanity that's going on with the fanatic Islamic groups that threaten to take over the world, and though power, as far as power is concerned, they can't do it. But when you see somebody's head chopped off, it scares the shit out of you.
And when you see what's going on in Syria, it scares.
Yeah, that's just the north of here.
Do you believe?
No, but listen, there's also the left wing approach. Like, I have a friend. We talked about ISIS, and I said, what do you think the world should do with ISIS? And he said, build them schools, and they'll have what to lose. And I said, no, you build them schools, they'll have more places to rape. That's it. The only way you can meet groups like ISIS is in the battlefield with weapons. And I don't think that it's like Europe in 1938 appeasing. This is the reaction. I think that this is not going that way. But thank God.
So how do you see, you're a liberal?
Yep.
You're a progressive?
Yeah.
You still think a two-state solution is possible?
Definitely. I think that's the only hope this country has.
And where would that country, where would the Palestinian state be?
It would be in the ideal world. We would remove all the settlements, or 95% of them, It's not going to happen, though. This, you know, I'm just talking. This is I'm a disillusioned liberal. It's not going to happen. But at least don't settle anymore. The settlements are destroying the country, and it would be in the West Bank with and in Gaza with some kind of arrangements for them to pass between the two, some kind of connecting road between the two. It's not an ideal situation, but in times of peace and trust, then everything works, doesn't it? I mean, you have all sorts of weird.
And it would be its own nation, the nation of Palestine.
Well, you know, you'd go at it, I guess, in stages. You wouldn't give them an air force the next day.
Right.
And it would be the nation of Palestine. That's exactly what it would be.
And what do you think is the number, percentage-wise, of citizens of this new nation called Palestine who recognize the right of Israel to exist?
I don't know. That's a question I can't answer. I can answer how many people support in Israel what I'm saying. And that would be me, my wife. I'm not sure about my sister anymore.
And
there's a guy down the street that I spoke to. I think he's there's no support for that. I think if push came to shove and there was a real offer for peace, Israelis would then in a national poll they would support it. They would support some form of peace. Everybody was very pro-rubbing at the beginning, but when you have people exploding in buses and 30 people being wiped out at a shot, then it's hard to see the light at the end of that tunnel. It's a bloody tunnel.
Ehud Barak, before you go, Ehud Barak was defense.
He grew a beard. He's a hipster now.
He grew a beard. He was, I guess, the defense. He became defense minister after the Camp David Accords failed with Clinton in 2000. He became defense minister, and I remember him saying, we need to build a wall. Build a wall, and that will put an end to the suicide bombers. So they built a wall. They built a wall between the West Bank and Israel proper. And people say walls don't work, and walls are violating Palestinian rights and infringing on their land.
They are.
Yes.
Of course they are.
Did the wall work?
Of course.
Well, say that again.
There are almost no suicide bombers anymore.
So the wall did work.
No. It's not only the wall. It's intense work of intelligence in the occupied territories. By the way, there's a great television show called Fauda. It's on Netflix now. A guy I know. It happens that his daughter and my son go to the same school, in the same class, actually. He created it. It's called Fauda. Watch it. You will get insight to what's going on. It's not biased to Israel. It's a really good show.
How do you spell it?
Fauda. Fauda, I think. And it's on Netflix. It was subtitled, but it's really – it'll give you insight to how the day-to-day mechanism of the security of both sides works. Watch it.
Okay.
So I can't say it's only the wall, but the wall had a lot to do with it. But why am I saying the wall was infringing on Palestinian rights? Because it was built on Palestinian land. They could have built it, you know, a couple of miles west. They could have picked it up to the sky and done it on Israeli land. But no, they did it on Palestinian land. Does that bother me? Of course it bothers me. It didn't have to be done like that. It was insensitive. Israel is immune to any kind of humanity when it comes to that kind of stuff.
There are a million Arabs living in Israel proper.
I think there's more. There's 1,700,000 in there.
Do they identify as Israeli or do they identify as Palestinian? What would they call themselves?
I don't know. I'd say most of them identify as Palestinian. What do you identify yourself as?
Well, it's fluid. Some mostly a man.
Yeah, by the way, I've heard people talk about that. Don't be sure.
Do they call themselves Israelis?
I don't know. I imagine that a lot of them have a Palestinian sensibility. I mean, a generation and a half ago, they were Palestinians.
Do they vote in Israeli elections?
Not enough.
Do they pay taxes?
They have the – yeah, they do. They're supposed to. They don't go to the army. Some of them can volunteer.
They don't go into the army?
No, they're not. It's not mandatory for them to go into the army. Am I surprising you now?
Are they a fifth column?
I don't know. It's hard to say. As far as funds are concerned, they're the last priority of the Israeli government. When you go to one of these Arab villages, and they you can see sewage in the streets. Not all of them, but they're not. They don't get what the regular Israeli towns get. Cities.
When Israeli Arabs who have citizenship.
I don't know, but the question you're asking is, where is their loyalty? To who is their loyalty? Some, I guess it's, I don't know. I guess they're conflicted. The answer is somewhere in the middle. Who are you? I mean, you're an American and then a Jew. You're not loyal to Israel, but I'm just curious about how it would work for you.
You want to hear the best joke I wrote in 2016?
Yeah.
About Bernie Sanders?
Go on.
By the way, it's the best joke I ever wrote for 2016. Submitted it to
the buildup is terrifying. Go on.
It's the best joke I wrote all of last year. I submitted it to three separate shows that I was working on. Everybody said this is a great joke.
Nobody did it.
We can't do it. My concern about Bernie Sanders is, as a president, he's Jewish and an American, and there's a dual loyalty. What side will he take if America ever goes to war with Alan Sherman Records?
Right. Okay. And nobody did that?
And rightfully so.
Yeah. I had a joke like that. I had a joke that I wrote that nobody ever wanted to do. But it wasn't political. It was just some obscene joke about some lawyer, some female lawyer who was having an affair with the guy she was representing who was in jail. And she then said to the judge, deep inside, I know he's straight. And forget it. It doesn't translate into English, but...
Let me try, because I have one more question, then I'll let you go.
Yeah, go on.
I'll let you go. Finish the joke. Let me just see if it's...
No. Deep inside, I know that he's straight as a ruler, something like that. I don't think it translates.
What's the punchline?
Deep inside, I know that he's straight as a ruler. Deep inside, it was double meaning, but it doesn't translate.
Thank you for putting an end to that vicious stereotype that all Jews are funny.
I thought you did that at the beginning of the program. Oh, forget it.
Okay, last question.
Unless you're not Jewish.
We should do this more often. This was fun. Yeah. And I do think the listeners kind of got the lay of the land.
I don't know. It sounds kind of mumble-jumbled, and I didn't have the numbers right because I'm just on my job. But okay.
This is never going to be on CNN or MSNBC. Maybe Rachel Maddow.
But there are going to be hundreds of people listening to this. Literally hundreds of people.
You'd be amazed by how many listeners we have.
What, did you reach the 550?
We have a lot of listeners. We do, and it's growing because of shows like this.
By the way, my favorite show when I am in the States is the Mark Levin Show.
Oh, the right wing.
Yeah. Oh, that is so funny. It's like a parody. I developed imitations. I perform with that thing.
Have you ever heard of Michael Savage?
No.
Oh, you got to listen to Michael Savage.
I promise you, I will.
Michael Savage, SAVAG. His real name is Michael Wiener. He's a Jew from Brooklyn, he does the right wing act. And he's syndicated. He's very successful, very well-read, very literate. He's a combination of Jackie Mason, Mort Saul, and Strom Thurmond.
Wow, going back there.
Yeah, it's very entertaining. Final question.
Before you finish, I want to express a fear, by the way, that I don't think it's intentional, but I think that your new president, the president-elect, as he's called, until the 20th of January, is going to cause serious bloodshed in this area. If he does, in fact, move the embassy...
I was just going to ask you about David Freeman, the new ambassador to Israel from America.
He calls you a capo if you're in J Street.
Yeah. There are two lobbying organizations. They're not actually lobbyists, but they're called lobbyists. J Street and AIPAC. AIPAC is right-wing. J Street is a new left-wing Jewish lobbying organization. And David Friedman is Donald Trump's bankruptcy attorney, who's now going to be the ambassador to Israel. You would think, being Donald Trump's bankruptcy attorney, he'd be exhausted from all that work.
Work. The word you're looking for is work.
Yeah. And he wants to move the American embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem. And that is a bone of contention. Why is that significant?
What do you mean, why is it significant?
Huh?
Hold on. I'm just answering my writing partner who's freaking out.
Why moving the embassy from Tel Aviv to Jerusalem? Why will that alienate the world? And then you can go.
Thank you. You're a kind man. You're a kind Jew. I'm kind of a Jew. That you can tell me. I don't know. Or your ex-wife's side. She will know how much of a Jew you actually are. That and the Moel.
That's the guy who does the... That's the Jewish penis barber who takes a little... He takes a little off the top. But leave the sides. Leave the sides.
Yeah. And he earns most of his money in tips. Anyway, I apologize for that. Anyway, it's because it's declaring something that hasn't been finalized. Listen, as an Israeli and a Canadian and American, but an Israeli, the capital of Israel is Jerusalem. No way. You're not going to convince me that it's not. But there is a problem with East Jerusalem, where you have hundreds of thousands of Arabs living. Should it be Israel's capital? Yes. Should it be the capital of the Palestinian state? Yes. In some kind of phenomenal peace agreement where everybody loves everybody, it's a joint capital. But we are not there yet. We are decades, maybe centuries away from that. By moving the embassy to Jerusalem, you are declaring that this is the capital. You are finalizing something that has not been finalized. Should it be there? Theoretically, yes. Can it be there now? No. It will create violence that is unbelievable. There are certain areas you do not touch. One is like the dome of the mosque, Arab mosque on top of the in Jerusalem, on top of the mount, where the Western Wall is. Don't touch it. Jews shouldn't go up there. There's all sorts of areas that are very, very, which, in my opinion, it's all insane. But be smart.
Didn't Sharon initially?
Hold on. There's something about being smart and not being right. I'll give you another example. If I was right wing, how did Israel magnetize such anger on itself? There was a law passed. There's in the Israeli parliament, there's three stages for passing a law. One thing is a law called Chok HaHasdara, the law of regulation, I guess, which basically, in very simple terms, says any land that Israel confiscates from Palestinians in the occupied territories can become legal if we compensate in a certain way. And it's basically regulating illegal stuff, in which case the Supreme Court will not be able to say you can't do that. There, it's a way around the Supreme Court. Now, when Israel passed this law, in the State Department, they were freaking out. This is like in October, I think, or November. They were freaking out. Why pass that law? If they had any brains in their head, they would have waited till after the election. They would have waited till the 20th of January. They would have passed a law. Then they would have – nothing would have happened. But I just don't get it. There's some kind of insanity of taking on the world. And it's a little country. And Netanyahu is now scaring the shit out of the world by reprimanding everybody. Anyway.
Didn't Sharon light the fire for the Second Intifada?
Oh, yes, of course. He went up to the Temple Mount, definitely. He was the guy that did it. Just for your listeners that don't know, the Temple Mount is an area that Jews, according to certain halachic, that's a rabbinic authorities, you're not supposed to go up there for Jewish reasons, for religious reasons. Other Jews have found ways to go around that. It's a very explosive area. Don't go up there. There's no reason to go up there unless you want to make a point and you want to light a fire. Sharon did go up there, but that was to topple the government that was in Barak's government that was around before that. That was a calculated, cold and calculated political move. But back to your question. I fear that Trump's support, blind support of Israel, support of, supporting the settlements, sending an ambassador who was basically was right-wing as the settlers themselves, sending a guy like that in is going to ignite fires. It's not a wise thing to do. Even if you're right wing, you should be smart about what you're doing and not try to make a point.
Last two bonus questions.
Okay. Well, it's a yes and a no, depending on, you know.
Socialized medicine?
Don't start me on that one. Are you serious now?
Yeah, it works, right?
Well, I would know, you wouldn't. Yeah, let me tell you something, it works. I have a brother whose stepson had cancer. If my brother didn't have money, that kid would be in the ground now. But he's not. He's healthy. It's unbelievable. It's just phenomenal. I'll never get this. I don't know if this is true. I heard that Doctors Without Borders, you know that thing, doctors that go around the world?
I have a mother without borders.
I have a country without borders. But anyway, you know what I'm talking about? Doctors.
Sure. Yeah, they're heroes. Yeah.
Yeah, right. They go to Africa. They go to poor countries in Asia. The most work they had was in California. Is that true? I'm not sure. It's a funny story.
Oh, they had like medical fairs, I think, in Inglewood, and people came out. People are in trouble here in the United States.
This is you live in an insane country. A country that looks at socialized medicine as a communist plot is insane. It's just, I guess that a guy that doesn't work is entitled to, I don't know, he's not entitled for a trip around the world. He shouldn't have a swimming pool in his backyard, but he should be able to get chemotherapy. That, yes, whether he works or not.
Well,
that's irrelevant.
You have a draft?
What do you mean a draft?
You have a draft. The reason.
I have a play. I wrote a play and I have a draft. Yeah, you want it?
No, the reason Israel has socialized medicine is because everybody has to serve in the military.
Bullshit. No, that's not true.
Well, if you're not Orthodox.
No, everybody. No. Israel was founded as a welfare state. Like Canada, like England, like Sweden, it's less of one now. It's becoming more like America. But the basic foundations of a welfare state, which is socialized medicine, is that feature is still there. It has nothing to do with the army. It's just the way a country is run. Yeah. How many countries do you think don't have socialized medicine? Most of them do. It's just
industrial. Yeah. But you do have to serve in the military in Israel. And I think that makes for a smarter citizenry. You pay attention if you got some skin in the game. And Olmert.
That's not why Israel has socialized medicine.
Okay. Olmert, is he still in prison?
Yeah. And our president just got out of prison.
How many years?
Our president was in prison. Sounds like a tongue twister. Our president was in prison. Our president, Katsav, the guy before Peres, was in prison for rape. I think on two accounts he was convicted.
What's his last name?
Katsav, which means in translation, butcher. He was in prison for rape and...
Not all. I thought it was Olmert.
Oh, no. Olmert is also... He was the prime minister. Israel has a president, which is a totally useless thing. He just shakes people's hands. He's like the queen, but with a penis. It's because there's never been a female president. And he shakes people's hand, and he's the head of state. And after the election, he calls on the guy. It's his decision to call on the guy to form a government, who's going to be prime minister. But it's basically a ceremonial thing. So Israel's president was in prison for 5 years for rape. And Israel's prime minister, former one, Olmert, is in prison now, I think, got 4 or 5 years for taking bribes. So you could say one of two things now. Israel is a very, very honest, clean country because, look, we even put our presidents and prime ministers in jail. Or everybody is corrupt and their day will come.
Well, I think we should be putting... when Gerald Ford pardoned Nixon and said, our national nightmare is over, they always say it's good for the country. And why is it good for the country if we don't lock up our presidents? You know,
not good for the country.
What?
Oh, it's not good for the country. It's lies, suddenly contempt. I don't think it's good for the country.
You think it's when Trump was saying lock her up? You think that's bad for the country?
Of course that's bad when he was saying lock up Hillary Clinton.
But don't you think it's noble that a country can put a president and prime minister on trial and lock him up?
Definitely, yes.
You think it's good, right?
Yes, of course. But that's not the case of Hillary Clinton. That was not the case for her. That was just a ploy to an election ploy. It was an insane populist and election ploy, lock her up. We'll never understand what went on there with this guy Comey coming out 12 days before the election. I don't get it. It's like, it reminds me of, it's worse than what goes on here, by the way, when it comes to the election. It's just insane.
Daniel Lappin is a terrific comedy writer, and he's the creator of Israel's longest running sitcom, Life Isn't Everything. How can people contact you and complain?
First of all, after some of the stuff I said, I'm sure that I'll be contacted by people that are not happy. How can they contact me? What do you want me to give, my phone number?
Do you
my
have
address?
Twitter? Do you have Twitter?
I am on no social media.
Any Let anti-social media?
That's a good one. But time is such a valuable thing. And the amount of time that is wasted, I mean, as it is, I surf the web. Like when I have to write something, suddenly it's important to discover who invented the pencil. So I will spend 10 minutes, who invented the pencil. So there's enough time wasting as it is doing the dishes. You know what it is like to write. You'd rather do anything than write. So getting on social media, I think that's, you know, that's a limit I put on myself. It's like, you know, going on a diet. I have no social media. I have an email. I can give you my email if you want to write me.
Well, do you want to let my listeners?
Yeah, I don't care. I have several emails. One that's stuff I don't read. I'll give you the one I don't read, okay?
Well, then they're not going to take it down.
I read. They read it. I'm joking. I'm just so hilariously funny right now. It's D for Daniel Lappin, Lappin, at NetVision. NetVision .net.il. Now let's do that in a more coherent way. D Lappin at netvision.net.il. I can be contacted like that.
Great. Thank you, Daniel.
Great talking to you again. If ever you need a misrepresentation of history, I'm here for you.